On the new Restaurant Influencers podcast, you will learn how to tell your story online and how to be found. We have teamed up with Entrepreneur Magazine, Yelp, and Toast, our primary point of sale partner, to bring you this weekly video series. Please subscribe so you do not miss an episode. And if you'd like to learn more about the show, visit us at calibbq.media. Welcome to Restaurant Influencers, powered by Entrepreneur and Yelp. My name is Sean Walchef, founder of Cali Barbecue Media. In life and in the restaurant business, we learn through lessons and stories. Today's guest, we have Garry Kanfer of Kissaki brand. Hello. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So you, it's funny, we got this podcast set up through a mutual, well, a friend of mine through the digital space. His name's Kyle and Sarah. He's been a former guest on this show. So I came in blind and I did my digital deep dive in the lift on the way here. And the first thing you do is you go to an Instagram page. And through that Instagram page took me to your mobile first website. And your mobile first website took me to this plethora of press. Literally, we started this podcast to find restaurant influencers. What you are doing in the city, what you are doing with your brand, is exactly why we started this show. How did you do it?
Well, I am myself, I would consider myself a branding marketing guy. I own an agency called Big Drop, and at Big Drop, we work with a lot of Fortune 500 companies. Our biggest clients are in the city, Northwell, Altice. We have done work for brands like Samsung, Citibank, you name it. The majority of the big brands came through the door of this agency. At one point, I kind of plateaued as a CEO of the agency, and I was looking for a challenge in my life, and I got into the hospitality industry. Actually, downstairs...
That's quite a challenge.
Yeah, well, downstairs, there was a retail shop where years ago there used to be a old coffee place. They went out of business about 4 or 5 years ago. And every time I would walk to work, I would just pass by and I would say to myself, I'm going to do something here. And at that time, I was a big fanatic of omakase, which is chef's choice. So if you guys don't know what omakase is, you come to a sushi bar and you just tell the chef what allergies you have, and then the chef just, cuts the fish, makes the rice, and gives you a sushi piece, which is called a nigiri. And piece by piece, it's like you're in his world and it's his choice. And for me, I while working the agency, I would go myself even sometimes at lunch, and I would try all those different omakase spots. And I started doing research. I seen that there definitely was a margin. It was a pretty good model. And I said to myself, one day, I want to get into it. But I was also looking into a coffee brand. I was a fanatic in coffee as well. And in New York City, you know, you had so many, I consider them, I would say the second generations were the Starbucks, and then the third generations were like the Bluestone Lane and the Birch Coffees. And they were just, before COVID, they were just exploding around the city. And my first choice was to open a coffee shop. And that's how, you know, we started doing our research. We did the naming. My agency is called Big Drop, and we came out for the coffee brand and we called it The Drop.
I love that.
The Drop, one of them. Message and drop everything, make something. When I got when I rented the unit downstairs, I'm like, you know, this is so big. What am I going to do with this? And I came up with the idea to open up a secret room in the back with an omakase bar.
Really?
Yeah.
How big was the space?
It's about 1,800 square feet.
Okay.
So, you come in, it's a coffee shop, and in the back.
So how much of the space did you use for the coffee brand?
I would say it's 50-50. They share a kitchen.
Wow.
Yeah.
And what year did you do this?
That was our first one. So what was happening, I partnered up with a chef that had his own omakase brand in Astoria called Gaijin, and he wanted to leave for opportunity growth. So we met in this office. You know, he definitely liked that I was an agency guy. You know, I had already experience with growth. And about 7 to 8 months before COVID, we started building the brand. Went through naming, came up with Kissaki, means the tip of the knife. And that was supposed to be our first one. We didn't open it because of COVID.
Mm-hmm.
When we were building it, you know, there was, it was taking so long. So in the middle of building it, I found a place on Bowery. And while this was building, I convinced my partner, like, we gotta, listen, this is taking too long. You know, he's leaving from his current place. Where are all his people gonna go? They're gonna go to other places. Let's get this thing going on Bowery. I basically built our first and flagship location in Bowery in about 3.5 months.
3.5 months. Yeah, that's incredible.
I GC'd the project myself. we opened. I thought I had a lot of GC experience after just putting in a pool in my house in Long Island. So
that's fantastic. You sound like my grandfather.
I dove right in, you know, while building this one.
Yes.
So
of course.
I dove right in. We opened 45 days before COVID. And it was a success from the start. Then COVID happened, and we didn't have a to-go model. We had nothing. So we were all, and my wheel started spinning. I feel like if I was in the industry long enough, I wouldn't have that kind of motivation, because it's a tough industry.
Very tough.
Very tough, but I wasn't in the industry for too long. I mean, I was.
Did you have restaurant clients? With the agency, yeah.
We did LaCroix.
Okay.
The drink. Maybe there's a couple of restaurants in the beginning stages, but restaurants don't have the budgets for agencies.
Correct.
They don't invest a lot into their marketing. They don't invest a lot into their packaging. And the ones that are successful do, like Carbone. If you look at their bags, I remember even when in the beginning of days of being in Big Drop, I remember their bags. I was like, whoa, you know. And for me, it was always, you invest into the brand and, you know, there is a cost in the beginning, but at least, you know, you're different and you're sending a different message to the consumer. And it's not like just comparing every restaurant. It's like, why is this restaurant different? It's about, you know, the way how you're treated when you come inside of the restaurant. It's the way how their website works. It's the way, you know, how they serve their food. So for me, I consider myself being a pro in user experience and user experience online. And then, you know, your whole experience when you're coming into the restaurant and by how you're greeted, by everything, I feel like it falls in line with the user experience on digital.
Yeah, so our philosophy is digital hospitality. All businesses needs to be digital first, no matter if you're a retail business or a restaurant business.
Yeah.
You have to invest in the infrastructure
of
that online experience.
Yeah.
And every business is in the hospitality business.
Yeah.
One of the things I love about what you're telling me is how important the story is and how important the brand is.
Yeah.
For somebody that's listening to this podcast that's thinking about getting into the hospitality space, getting into the restaurant space, what advice would you have when they're building a brand? What does brand mean to you?
A brand means a lot. I feel like you need to think about the person that's actually your target audience, the people that you're trying to deliver the product to. How are they looking at it? What are they supposed to feel? What's the competitive analysis? I remember building Kissaki. We spent a lot of time on branding, on brand positioning, on the competitive analysis. And if you're looking at an oversaturated market, then, you know, your research is important. Sometimes I feel like some brands that spend so much in opening the restaurant, if they would just spend a little bit more on doing their research, they would probably be able to save a lot of that burn in the beginning. But it matters who your partner is on the digital side, because a lot of companies that are out there, they're just there to take your money.
Yeah.
So it's important to, you know, pick a good partner, and it's important to do a lot of stuff in-house yourself.
So that's I love the in-house part because not everyone's going to build an agent. No one's going to build an agency then to build the restaurant. But one of the things that we like to talk about is smartphone storytelling. There's never been a time where the democratization of technology has allowed someone that's a single unit barbecue restaurant owner to partner with Yelp, an entrepreneur, to do incredible things. What do you see moving forward for restaurants and hospitality as far as this digital smartphone storytelling?
Well, I feel like restaurants should definitely invest into their brand. Some of them do, but the thing is that a lot of restaurants, they just don't have the funds. But there is certain ways how to do certain things where it's, there's workarounds. There's freelancers. There's websites like Upwork, where you could find maybe a branding, someone that could just build your brand cheaper than going to an agency. I feel like it's important to invest into your content. It's important to explain to the consumer who you are. What is the point? What is the point for them coming into the sushi bar? There's so many different sushi bars. How are you guys different? You don't have to be better than others, but they need to understand what you're standing, like why you're there, like what are you trying to do, what are you trying to achieve, and that message is so important. And I walk around and I just see all these restaurants, and I'm just like looking at the restaurant on the corner that's opening up, and it used to be roast. They went out of business, had a good model, went out of business, but. And now I'm just looking at this. I don't remember the name of the restaurant that's going in, but just by me just looking at that, just their logo and not understanding what they're about and what they do, I just feel like they have such a disadvantage. I feel like they didn't spend enough time on understanding who they really are.
I love that you say that because once you understand who you are, it becomes not only easy for you to market your own message, but really what we talk about is you go from marketing to media, where you're creating a story where other people are actually going to carry your story forward. The way that you've generated so much press, legacy media, you can create your own media. Literally, we got ignored for 5 years in a location. We thought we were doing great work. No one cared in San Diego. No one cared about us. No one wrote about us. No one came out with the local news. But then we started creating our own story, telling our own story. And now we have all those opportunities. What advice do you have to somebody that is trying to get their story heard if they're in the business?
I feel that it's important to have a good story. I feel like that we what really helped us it's COVID helped us. I feel like
But you leaned into it.
we leaned
You
into
weren't
COVID.
shy.
We were not shy,
You
and
weren't shy to answer questions.
we so what happened was is that during COVID, everything just froze. Everybody was scared. They wanted to take a break, and they didn't really understand what was going on. For me, I'm like, you know what? This is an opportunity. We don't have our logistics. We don't have our to-go model. At that time, we let go of our creative department at Big Drop. All I had is a designer, and I just took the creative role, and I just started designing these boxes. So my idea was like, all right, so we're delivering omakase in the restaurant. How can we give that same experience to someone at home? So I just started working. I found ways. So it takes a lot of hustle. I went on Alibaba. I found packaging companies. I did all the logistics myself. I had no experience on how to get product from China, all customs, all the logistics. And I designed this box
It's a
where,
beautiful
you
box. For
know,
those of you
so,
watching on
yeah,
YouTube, if you're
so.
listening on podcast, check out the YouTube so you can
Yeah,
see the box that
so
he's
it's the bot.
designed.
There's this nice sushi, and I felt like, you know what? Once it's like a wife bringing, I mean, a wife or a husband,
Wife or
but yeah,
husband.
a wife or a husband bringing their significant other, a shoe box, like they would, or a bag box or something, just
Well,
opening it
it's
up.
an Apple experience. I mean, that's what we're all searching for, is how do you make that to go, that packaging, so that you actually feel there's love that went into that design.
It did. And, you know, that's the wallpaper that we have in our restaurant, the fish. And I felt like, you know what, giving them the experience at home. And it just, I remember the first day we opened to go, we had a line out the door. Just, it was a line. We like had no to-go experience. At one point, I looked at the chef. He looked at me. I looked at the tickets. I thought he was going to walk out. We got through that day.
Restaurant nightmare.
And, our to-go model strives significantly. We were part of the omakase series that the Eater did about our to-go motto. I feel like if we didn't do the to-go model, we would have been dead in the water. So I pivoted from the to-go model. I got into the Hamptons. I opened the Hamptons location. From the Hamptons, I got into Greenwich and other locations. And I was just pivoting.
So how many locations are you?
We have five locations. And
you've expanded five locations.
Five are in the works that are going to open within a year. We have a pretty good executive team. We're still working on culture. We still have a lot of issues. But I think we're doing well as a team, and we're learning. We're growing. We're learning from our mistakes, and we're getting better.
So I have a two-part question. What keeps you up at night? And then what wakes you up? What pulls you out of bed in the morning?
What pulls me out of bed in the morning? So there's two variances for that. Sometimes at 3 a.m. I'll wake up and I'll just look through my phones. I'll look through emails. But lately I've been getting away from that because I know I'll be up till 4:30, 5 a.m. And the other thing that wakes me up, one of my three kids that are under seven. I have a 2-year-old, a 5-year-old, and a 7-year-old.
You do? Yeah, wow. So congratulations. So, yeah. I have a 4-year-old and a 2-year-old.
Yeah.
So yeah, if they're not waking you up or keeping you up.
Yeah.
But that's why we do it, right?
Yeah. No, it definitely, I definitely struggle with the work-life balance. My wife always complains that I never give enough time to the family. I mean, I definitely have to work on it. I'm getting better, but it's tough. It's tough. For me, it's about what's important for me. It's just what I enjoy is seeing other team members grow.
Yeah.
So if they're growing, they're growing with me, that means I'm doing a good job. So for me, it's to hire the right person, to make sure they have the right material and that they're set up for success, and then have a system in place that monitors KPIs and certain things. It's important to see the problem before it's the problem. So what I'm working right now is, on all these visualizations, dashboards, KPIs, for example, why is this one waiter earning more tips than the other waiter? Mm-hmm. How much can the sushi chef comparing other, and that's granular. I think we have a lot of more other things that we're trying to, a lot of things that has to come together on the macro side before we get on the granular side. But, we're building. And one of my challenges in this industry, I feel like this industry is a dinosaur in technology.
Yes.
So when I started building this logistic company, you had to, for online ordering, it was one system. For reservations, it was another system. Connecting everything to your POS. But sometimes your POS doesn't integrate with a driver, like DoorDash drive. And not only that, I'm used to, looking at ROIs, what's my cost per acquisition, what's my lead cost, what's my conversion cost. And none of the online platforms, they don't even let you put a pixel on the website to track your conversions. So if someone is purchasing something from your website and you're using the third party platform, they don't even have a pixel in place to show you what your cost per acquisition is. Mm-hmm. That's another thing that we've been working on 6 to 7 months, which is a good story. I come from the agency and sure. I'm in the restaurant industry. So we've been building a platform called Tastely.
Cool.
With Big Drop.
Really?
Yeah. And it's a all-in-one online ordering, reservation, and a marketing tool for small restaurants that are able to grow their brand through SMS, through integrating, their Instagram accounts and tracking their conversions, Because look, you might have a good product, right? There's a lot of restaurants that have a good product, but if you don't know how to market that product,
correct,
it's going to be challenging. Mm-hmm. You know, for me, I'm very big on ads. So I'm very big on the, you know.
Why is it important? I think it doesn't get talked about enough, and I'm happy that you brought it up, especially with an agency background.
I know what my cost per each reservation is, so I could grow it faster because I know if I could push on, you know, so I'm getting my reservation, my cost per reservation, for example, is $40. My revenue per reservation is $500, right? For example, because 2.5 people, on average, it's about $500. It's higher ticket items at the omakase bar. The $40 will make sense. If I am a fast food place, the $40 is not going to make sense. Correct. But there's, you know, there's different things that you could do. Why is it important? Because you could control your revenue than just opening your doors and hoping, like, who's going to call me, who's going to make a reservation, what's going to happen today. So that's very important. The problem is if the cost per acquisition, the reservation is higher than, you know, well, you need to first know, like, what makes sense for me. So the consumer comes in once, like, but, you know, he's going to, it's the lifetime. So what's the lifetime cost? So all of that, you know, you need to put some thought in it and you need to create a system that you need to follow, which helped me grow faster. And some people like, oh, how did this guy grow so fast? And first of all, we have a good product. Thanks to my chef and the culinary team, you know, the product is good.
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, now the product at his old restaurant, the product was similar, but it didn't have that kind of brand behind it. Yeah. Now the product is something else and has a lot to do with the brand.
You added gasoline to the fire.
Yeah.
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 So the last question I want to ask you about is something that means a lot to me. It's something that I failed at early on and I'm still working at. It's surrounding myself with mentors and coaches, people that are going to push me to be better. And a lot of the times I didn't even realize early on that I actually did have mentors and coaches. Who inspires you and who helps you along your way?
Man, I wish I had more mentors. I feel like I might not be a good example for that because I feel like I just been pushing myself, and I feel like seeing, you know, my family growing, kids, and knowing that I have to do it for the family and for their future. And, you know, I came here, I was an immigrant. I came from the former USSR, Russia, when I was 7 years old. You know, we were okay there, but once we came here, we had nothing.
Yeah.
So, you know, my kids are doing better than me.
Yeah.
You know, we live in a house. They're going to better schools. So I wish I had mentors, and it probably would have helped me tremendously. And something that I'm like, I always think about, oh, I wish I had a good mentor. You know, right now I'm at a stage where I am speaking to a lot of serious people that I'm hoping might be mentors for me. Mm-hmm. But for me, I feel like it's my own drive. It's my drive and just thinking about, you know, the growth of the company and thinking about doing something good for this industry and seeing the growth of my family.
I appreciate your vulnerability. It's It means a lot. And I hope people that are listening to this podcast that you understand somebody's as successful as Garry is willing to share that he doesn't have a mentor. Imagine when he actually surrounds himself with mentors. I can't even see what you're going to build. I mean, it's super exciting. Thank you so much for taking the time.
No problem.
Where's the best way for people to connect with you online?
My Instagram account is Garry with two R's, Garry Kanfer. I feel like someone's messaging me. I'm always reading, or LinkedIn. You could find me on LinkedIn.
Awesome. Garry Kanfer, thank you so much. You guys can connect with me at Sean P. Walchef on all the social handles. If you want to reach out, Sean @Cali Barbecue Media. We appreciate you listening to the show. Catch you next week.